program at Holstein Brazilian Only Labs. And since a few months, I'm also CTO of our spin-off company making ALD equipment. And this is what I'm going to talk about today. I know you've already had to digest a lot of information about ALD in general and different kinds of precursors and lots of chemistry. So in my presentation, not too much chemistry because I'm not a chemist. I'm going to talk about something that most of you will probably not do during your PhD, that is designing your own ALD reactor. Most of you will be users of an existing ALD reactor. But it's good for you to understand how an ALD reactor works and what the basic idea behind such a machine is. Alright, so the purpose of an ALD or an MLD reactor is to expose a substrate to ALD precursors, as discussed earlier today, in order to do an ALD or an MLD deposition in such a way that it happens first, controlled. You want to have a certain thickness, you want to have a certain material, and of course you want to get this out of your reactor at the end of your experiment. It has to be reproducible. So every time you want to have the same result, the same thickness and the same material. And of course safe, because we often deal with flammable, pyrophoric or even toxic precursors. So how do we do this? In the coming hour to 1.5 hour, I'm going to zoom in on these four topics. First, a little bit about ALD, MLD reaction kinetics as a background. I will explain the basics of an ALD-MLD reactor. I will discuss a little bit about upscaling reactors, and in the end, about methods for precursor supply. So as we heard today quite extensively already, ALD and MLD, so if I say ALD, I mean both ALD and MLD, is based on sequential chemical reactions. So in the most basic form, we have a reactive surface site, we have a gaseous precursor, and they react with each other to form a absorbed species or moiety on the surface. And this is of course true for both half reactions. And as probably you remember from high school or university chemistry, all chemical reactions are governed by thermodynamics and reaction kinetics. So thermodynamics tells you something about whether or not a chemical reaction will occur spontaneously. They will only occur spontaneously if the difference in energy of your initial reactants and your final reaction product is such a way that your final reaction product has a lower Gibbs free energy. If that is the case, your reaction will occur spontaneously. Well, let's now assume that we do ALD, MLD reactions that indeed are, for instance, exothermic, and they will occur spontaneously. But thermodynamics does not say anything about the rate, the speed of a reaction, how fast will the reaction happen. This is reaction kinetics. And the rate of a chemical reaction is determined by a number of chemical kinetic parameters, like the reactivity of the precursors. We've heard some examples today of very reactive kinds of precursors like trimethyl aluminum, which is very reactive to water, for example. Also, reaction temperature is very important. Of course, the concentration of the reactants during a gas phase reaction is important. And the reaction time also determines how your reaction occurs. And the effects of the kinetic parameters on the reaction rate can be quantified or summarized through the rate equation. So let's look at this very simple reaction where you have a gaseous precursor, you have a surface site reacting to a absorbed surface species. And we can write down a rate equation something like this, where this term here is the reaction rate. So this is the concentration of my absorbed species, the red dots here, as a change in time, as it increases in time, is a function of a kinetic coefficient. And this kinetic coefficient contains information about the precursor reactivity, sticking coefficient for example, but also deposition temperature. It also depends on the concentration of my precursor and of course the concentration of reactive sites on the surface. This is a very elemental reaction rate equation. So let's try to solve this equation, to start with the precursor concentration. So if we assume the precursor vapor to be an ideal gas, there's actually a relation between concentration, units moles per cubic meter, for example, and its pressure. Through this equation. So the precursor concentration is a function of the precursor pressure at a constant temperature. So it's commonly in gas phase reactions we use precursor pressure as a measure for concentration. Furthermore, if we have a mixture of gases in a certain volume, for instance, if we suppose we have a mixture of nitrogen and a precursor vapor, then the total pressure of that volume of gas, you can say it's a combination of the sum of the partial pressure of the nitrogen and the partial pressure of your precursor. This is Dalton's law, for those who remember this from university. And it's actually the precursor partial pressure that is the measure for concentration. So if we would increase, in this case, the nitrogen pressure, and we would let the total pressure increase, the precursor partial pressure would not change. And it is precursor partial pressure that is the measure of concentration. Another thing that we can do to solve this reaction rate equation is to rewrite it in terms of surface coverage. The surface coverage, the symbol often used is the Greek letter theta, describes the fraction of available sites on the surface that have reacted with a precursor molecule. So in this case, we have a surface with many reactive sites, but no precursor molecules present, and there we have a coverage of zero. The other extreme is where all the surface sites are covered, have reacted with a precursor molecule. There we have a coverage of one. And of course, we can have every value in between. And we can define theta as the ratio of the reacted sites divided by the total available sites in the beginning. So then we can do some juggling with Greek letters and symbols, and then we end up with a redefined rate equation, now in terms of surface coverage, where again we have this reaction rate coefficient that holds a temperature dependency, the precursor partial pressure, and theta saying something about the coverage. And we can solve this differential equation, here it is, and this is more or less a sort of basic ALD half reaction equation. It contains three terms. Again, the reaction rate coefficient, the precursor partial pressure, and now the reaction time. And these are the main three kinetic parameters in an ALD half reaction. So if we plot this equation as the coverage, which is a measure of the growth per cycle, as a function of reaction time, we get this characteristic ALD curve. So if we increase reaction time, the growth per cycle increases until it reaches a plateau, where the GPC does not increase anymore if you keep on exposing it to more precursor. So what happens if we, so this is the green term over here. What happens if we increase the partial pressure? It's basic chemistry. If you increase the concentration during a chemical reaction, the rate will increase, so the reaction will go faster. So we will reach this plateau, this saturation, at a shorter reaction time. What happens if we, for instance, decrease deposition temperature? Well, one of the things that can happen is that the growth per cycle increases. Might also decrease, a little bit complicated, but you can see that the point is that these all three kinetic parameters, they play an important role in the outcome of your reaction. So coming back to my opening statement, the purpose of an ALD-MLD reactor is to controllably, reproducibly, and safely execute an ALD reactor. So how do we do this? We use our reactor to control these three kinetic parameters. We control reaction temperature, we control precursor partial pressure, and we control the reaction time. That is what an ALD machine does. Nothing more, nothing less. So this brings me to the basics of an MLD reactor. And in the coming minutes, I'm going to explain a very, very simple ALD reactor. None of you will work with a reactor that looks like this. It's just the most simple version of an ALD reactor that you can imagine, and I will use this as a starting point for more complicated machines in the coming slides. And as to remind you, what we do in this reactor is we control deposition temperature, we control partial pressure, and we control time. To start with the reaction chamber, usually most ALD reactors is a vacuum chamber, it's a steel vessel. with a pump connected, where the background pressure is like a few millibar or a few torr, depending on which unit you use. And it has a valve and a pump to control the chamber pressure. There can be a nitrogen supply if you want to do some purge, and the chamber is pumped down to a background pressure, whatever background pressure you want. This can be very low. This can be up to atmospheric pressure. A purge gas supply for nitrogen or argon or some other inert gas is sometimes connected via a valve. So this round thing with a cross is a symbol for a valve. In most cases, the sample, this one over here, is placed on a substrate holder, a chuck. And the substrate holder can be heated in many cases to heat up the substrate, to heat up your sample. And this way you can control the temperature of the sample, and this way you can control the deposition temperature. So here is our first knob to turn for doing a successful ALD experiment. We can control the reaction deposition temperature via this heated chuck. This is, I think, relatively straightforward. Then precursor supply. In most cases, we use liquid precursors, and it is usually stored in a precursor vessel, like this one. It can be steel, it can be glass. It is connected to the reactor through a pipe, and in between the reactor and the precursor vessel, there's usually at least one, but in most cases more valves to separate the chamber from your precursor. Now, above the liquid precursor, there is a buildup of vapor of your precursor liquid, and the pressure above your precursor liquid is typically the equilibrium vapor pressure. Now, when we make sure that the chamber background pressure is lower than the vapor pressure of this vapor in the precursor vessel, and if we open this valve, then precursor will flow into your chamber. And now the chamber pressure is the product of the sum of the background pressure plus the vapor pressure. And if the vapor pressure is high enough as compared to the background pressure, we have our new reactor pressure is approximately the vapor pressure of the precursor. And this is what now has happened is that the substrate is now exposed, well, when this valve is open here, to a precursor partial pressure equal to the vapor pressure. So here we have the first step in controlling the partial pressure during our ALD experiment. Now, the vapor pressure of a precursor varies with temperature. So a very simple way of increasing the vapor pressure, and with that increasing the partial pressure, so the concentration of your precursor in the reactor, is by heating it up. So you can put a heating jacket around your precursor vessel, or you can put it in a heated water bath or oil bath, any way to heat it up. For example, here I have the vapor pressure as a function of temperature for trimethyl aluminum. This is for a very often used silicon oxide precursor. And you can see that by increasing the temperature from 25 to 50 degrees C, that's a factor of 2, the vapor pressure increases an order of magnitude of TMA. So controlling temperature is a very efficient way of controlling the vapor pressure, and with that, the partial pressure of your precursor inside your reactor. Of course, you have to make sure that if you heat up your precursor, that if your lines, if your gas lines here are not isolated or not heated, you get the chance of condensation of precursor in your gas lines, and you have to prevent that by also heating the rest of your system. So the vapor pressure, and with that the partial pressure, can be increased by heating the precursor. You can also open the valve to the vacuum pump to have a constant flow of precursor coming from your precursor vessel through the chamber towards your pump. And this is also a way to control your chamber pressure, and with that, again, your partial pressure. But of course, this will lead to a little bit of reduction in your partial pressure, but gives you more control of your reaction. So we have control of partial pressure through first the precursor temperature, with that the vapor pressure, and the pumping speed of your chamber. This was one precursor. Of course, we also have a very often needed second precursor, But everything, same holds there. You can heat it up to increase the vapor pressure. There's a precursor vessel connected with at least 1/4 to the chamber. You can also use plasma ALD. Then instead of a precursor vessel, we often have a plasma generator. This can be remote, so the plasma generator is apart from your, it's separated from your reactor through a valve. It can also be actually inside your reactor. So this is a whole topic by itself. We'll not touch upon this too much. This may be for some later workshop, but this is also a widely used technique in ALD. Now, then the third kinetic parameter is reaction time. So how do we control that? Well, as you can see here, there are four valves. There are valves separating the reactor from the precursors. There are valves between the purge line, and there's a valve between the pump and the reactor. Of course, these pumps are not manually operated. They are mechanical valves or electrical valves. They are connected to a computer in which you can type a recipe. I want to have my valve open for so many seconds at that moment, and then I want that valve to be open for so many seconds. So by automating these valves through your recipe that you put in your control computer, you can set the timing of opening and closing of these valves, and with that you control your third kinetic parameter, that is the reaction time. Again, not that complicated. So this brings us to the complete ALD cycle. We start with exposing the precursor, the substrate to precursor number one. And we can control the deposition temperature by using a heated chuck. We can control the partial pressure of your precursor by opening the valve through your precursor vessel and the reactor, maybe opening also the valve to the pump, and heating your precursor to increase partial pressure if required. And we do that for both precursors. We can control reaction time by automating the valves and through your recipe in the computer, say how long a valve will open and when it will close. So this is, in essence, how a very basic ALD reactor works. And again, none of you will work with an ALD reactor that looks exactly like this. But all ALD reactors that you will use are based around this principle. So to summarize this first part, the purpose of an ALD reactor is to controllably reproducible and safely do an ALD reaction on your surface. We can control reaction temperature by sample heating. We can control partial pressure through the precursor vapor pressure and pump speed and reaction time through automated valves. This is what an ALD reactor does, nothing more, nothing less. Now we're going to talk a bit more about real ALD machines that will be used by you and also are being used by industry. So most of you will work on R&D reactors in the labs of your universities or institutes. And there are many, many, many different kinds. This is one actually, this is pictures taken from a PhD thesis from Ghent University. This is a home-built ALD reactor. And as you can see, you recognize many parts. You have this copper block with the sample that can be heated. You have gas lines, you have precursor supply lines. Here you actually have a remote plasma source. And there's a pump, so it's a home-built system, but it's based on the principles I explained to you before. There are many other examples of home-built reactors. So this is a reactor that they use in the North Carolina State University. This is one of the speakers of, I think, Wednesday, Professor Jure. It is a very simple thing. It's a tube with a pump and a valve and a few gas supply lines, and it's built for flexibility. You can put in any substrate that you want, any size, flat. You can put a rolled up piece of paper in there if you want. So that's very nice for doing R&D. You can also buy commercial R&D systems. I looked up on the internet at all the partner institutes of HiCode, which ALD reactors they use. Actually, many of them use the ASM Microchemistry F120 machine. I don't think this one is still commercially available. It's a rather old machine, but it works perfectly, and many, many, many people active in ALD have learned ALD on such a machine. So if you have the privilege of working on the F120 reactor, it's a legend by itself, I think. Also other companies supplying R&D reactors, and for instance, Vanek and Picosun and Vico Cambridge Nanotech, but also one of our partners, CTEC Nano, also supplies R&D reactors. So many different shapes and sizes, and in most cases, they're not that complicated. It's a vacuum vessel with a few valves and a pump, and that's it. But let's say a few years from now, one of you, or maybe a few of you, will find a very successful MLD system, a new precursor, a new application, something that industry, that Samsung or Intel says, I want this. We want this in our fab. How are we going to do this? Because, of course, we cannot use R&D systems for industrial scale production. We have to upscale our ALD MLD process. So we have to upscale precursor synthesis, that's one thing, but of course we also need bigger machines because we need to handle many wafers or plates or rolls or whatever sample that you want to process. And there are a few key figures of merit that an industrial scale ALD process defines. First of all, there's the growth per cycle. This was already explained today. The growth per cycle is nanometer per cycle or angstrom per cycle. That is the thickness of the film that you deposit during one ALD cycle. Or actually, you do 100 ALD cycles, and then you measure the thickness and you divide it by 100, and that gives you your growth per cycle. And the growth per cycle is basically chemistry. It's the size of your precursor molecule, the size of the ligands plays a role that gives you the packing density. It's of course also a material property somehow, because if you have a crystalline material, it can be the unit cell size can play a role there. It's not much we can do with our equipment to increase the growth per cycle. For example, a traditional number, a growth per cycle of aluminum oxide is around 0.1 nanometer, or one angstrom. Very often people use the term deposition rate when they actually report growth per cycle. But deposition rate, the definition is actually nanometers per second, or thickness, the thickness that you deposit in an amount of time. So this could be calculated by taking the growth per cycle, this one over here, and dividing it by the total cycle time. And the total cycle time is a sum of your two precursor pulses and of course your two purge steps. That together gives you the cycle time, and that you can plug into this equation to calculate the deposition rate. For example, if we have a growth per cycle of 0.1 nanometer and let's say cycle time of 4 seconds, this means that we have a deposition rate of 0.025 nanometer per second. This is quite slow. And things get worse if you look at typical MLD cycle times. This morning we saw a few examples of MLD cycle times to be several tens, and in some cases even several hundreds of seconds. So the deposition rate will go down, maybe even orders of magnitude. And as Christoph already showed this morning, the rate at which the continents move apart from each other is at the rate of one or a few centimeters per year. This is an order of magnitude faster than a typical ALD reaction. So what we do is extremely, extremely slow. And of course, if you want to, you can imagine that if you're Intel or Samsung or whatever company using ALD to produce devices, you would like to produce as many devices as you can per day, because the more you can sell and the more profit you can make. So you would like to have your deposition rate as high as possible. But there is another key performance number, that's throughput. Throughput is something, let's say, wafers per hour, or ICs per hour, or let's say product divided by the number of products you can make in a unit of time. And you can calculate throughput in various ways. The simplest way is, let's say I produce wafers. I have my deposition rate R, which is given by the GPC divided by the cycle time. I have a desired thickness, because you can imagine if I need 10 nanometers or if I need 100 nanometers, that has a big impact on my throughput. And I can either produce one wafer for every deposition, or I can also maybe do a few wafers per deposition in sort of batch mode. And this 3600 is to calculate from hours, to a transfer between seconds and hours. So, for example, if I have a growth per cycle of 0.1, a cycle time of 4 seconds, this gives me my deposition rate of 0.025. Suppose I need 10 nanometers film thickness and I do one wafer per deposition. This means I can produce 9 wafers per hour. And I'm ignoring things like loading your wafer, and getting it out again, heating up, cooling down, pumping, all these kind of things. Just pure deposition time, 9 wafers per hour. That's not that much. So what can we do to upscale, to increase throughput? Well, first of all, we can increase the growth per cycle, because if we increase the growth per cycle, then we increase throughput. That's one thing that we can do, but it's mostly chemistry, not really equipment. We can also decrease the cycle time. If you go from 4 seconds to 0.4 seconds, we increase throughput a factor 10. And both of them have a very large chemical, so that's the choice of precursor. The growth per cycle is determined by a material in your precursor, but also the cycle time, so the exposure time that you need to have a self-limited reaction, depends a lot on reactivity of your precursor. So that's for the precursor chemists, not for the equipment builders. But we can also increase this value N by producing multiple wafers in one run. That's batch process. And actually, decreasing cycle time, we can do something with equipment, as I will show you. And of course, increasing this N, the number of multiple wafers we can produce in one run, is all given by reactor design. So, to start with the latter one, we can do batch processing. We can do many wafers in one deposition run. This is an example of, this is a commercial product of ASM. This is a big furnace, a big columnar furnace, which you can put 50 to 150 wafers, depending on the size. And during one deposition, we deposit all these wafers in a single run. This is another example from Benek. It's the same thing. I don't know if you can see, but all these little blue lines, these are individual solar cell wafers. You can put them all in one boat, put them in a machine, do a deposition, and during one deposition, all these, I don't know how many wafers there are, have been coated. And this way you can achieve a very high throughput, although the deposition rate might still be low, maybe even lower than for a single wafer reactor. And because you do so many wafers at the same time, you can increase your throughput to the levels that you want. You can also, as said, reduce the cycle time. And apart from looking at precursor chemistry, what you can do is you can try to maximize your precursor partial pressure, because as explained in the beginning, if you increase your precursor partial pressure, you increase your precursor concentration in a chemical reaction, and if you increase your reaction, then the reaction rate increases. And you will reach the point where you have saturation at a shorter reaction time. Well, this might not be possible. Another thing that you can do to minimize cycle time is by minimizing the purge time. So the cycle time is built up by the time it takes to expose the substrate to precursor A, precursor B, and to cycle times. Well, for a given precursor and a given deposition temperature, you have a given reactivity. Probably there's not much you can do in reducing the precursor pulse time. But if you can minimize the purge time by a clever design of your machine, you might be able to reduce the overall cycle time quite a lot, and hence increase the overall throughput. So one way to reduce cycle times by shifting ALD from the way we all know it, by separating precursor pulses in time to separating precursor supply in space. That's called spatial ALD. So this is a little bit of a cryptic graph, but on this axis we have time, this axis we have a substrate location. The orange and the blue ones are the precursor pulses, and the green things are the purges. So what we do in normal ALD is we do not move the reactor, so the substrate location remains unchanged. But over time, we expose it to first the first precursor, then the purge, second precursor, purged, first because of purge, etc., etc., etc. This is temporal ALD, as most of us do, but you can also do it differently. So instead of time, we can actually move the precursor from the first half reaction zone through the inert gas to the purge to the second half reaction zone, and then continue to go back and forth. So we actually move a precursor from one zone to the other. This is called spatial ALD, and one way of doing it is as already shown by Christophe this morning, is we have precursor zones separated by gas bearings or inert gas curtains, and then we move the substrate, for instance, in this direction, where here we have the first half reaction, there we have the second half reaction, and if we come out here, we have the ALD cycle complete. Of course, then we need to repeat, we can move back and forth, we can have a long tunnel where many of these spatial ALD injectors are in line. And with this technique, mainly because we can reduce the purge time to a very short time, we can increase deposition rates, let's say in the nanometer per second range, which is one or two orders of magnitude faster than temporal ALD. And maybe most importantly, it allows to go to high throughput systems, large area and roll to roll. And there are a number of spatial ALD reactors already developed and also being used. For example, in the biggest domain where ALD is being used anyway, the semicon industry to make computer chips and memory and all these kind of things. And big companies like Applied Materials, Intel and Samsung, they have spatial ALD machines in running in fabs at this moment. This is still on the silicon wafers, as we all know. You can also do ALD on very large, several square meter glass plates, for instance, for display applications. You can use ALD for high throughput crystalline silicon solar cell manufacturing. You can use ALD for spatial ALD for doing roll to roll, so coating plastic foil with an ALD or an MLD layer. You can even use it to do ALD on spatial ALD on powders for instance, battery or catalysis applications. And especially this one, the first example of an industrial scale roll-to-roll ALD production based on roll-to-roll is for making berry foils and is expected to start next year. So somewhere next year, there's a company who's going to produce rolls of plastic foil with an MLD-based process for making berry foils. And maybe starting from next year, we can actually buy products using an MLD berry layer in there. Unfortunately, I'm not allowed to say who or what, but MLD processes are getting into industrial scale manufacturing. So, this is about reactors. If we scale up a reactor in terms of throughput, so how many, if I go to many wafers per hour, or if I go to very large areas, you can imagine that the kind of precursor supply that you use in your R&D scale reactor for maybe 1 square centimeter substrates at some point is not enough anymore. Just to illustrate this, how much precursor do you actually need to supply? I'm going to show you a few calculations. Please don't pin me down on the exact numbers. This is just as an example to show you the effect of production scale on what you need to do for your precursor supply. So let's, for example, take a 10 centimeter wafer in an R&D reactor. The area is about 8 times 10 to the minus 3 square meter. And it happens that the number of reactive sites on a surface is somewhere around 5 times 10 to the 18th. Again, don't pay me down on real numbers, it's just an example. So we can calculate the number of sites that we have available for reaction by just multiplying these two and dividing it by Avogadro's constant, because otherwise we get crazy numbers. So we need about 7 times 10 to the minus 8 moles of precursor molecules to occupy each and every reactive site. And this corresponds to, let's say, around, if we're going to use TMA, 5 micrograms of TMA. Now, let's say we have a 1 second pulse time. And let's say we have a reaction probability of sticking coefficient of 0.1%. This means that of every 1,000 molecules hitting your surface, only one sticks. This is a sort of realistic number for a real ALD reaction. So this means that we need a flow of TMA of at least 6 milligrams per second. I'm not saying we need 6 milligrams, but this is the flow rate. 6 milligrams per second TMA flow is what we need to during our TMA pulse to go this wafer. And this is only taking in account this wafer. Of course, we also have your reactor walls and your substrate holder, which also will get coated by the ALD process. But let's forget this now. 6 milligram, that's not that much. TMA is a high vapor pressure. We don't worry too much about this this number. Now let's do a little bit of upscaling. Let's go to a 300 millimeter wafer. And 300 millimeter wafer is this moment in the semiconductor industry, the standard wafer size. We can calculate the area. We can calculate using the same numbers, the number of reactive sites. Using the same reaction probability and pulse time, we suddenly need about 10 times higher TMA flow. 60 milligrams per second. Again, okay, that's probably not too much of a problem. Now, this is a planar wafer. Now we go to a trenched wafer. So we have a 300 millimeter wafer, and on there are holes, trenches. And this is actually what happens in the semiconductor industry. They deposit on 3D, complicated 3D structures, like for DRAM or for transistors. And now, of course, the surface area increases a lot because we have not a flat surface, but we have all the side walls that also need to be covered. So let's say we have now an area of, let's say, 1.4 square meters on an effective surface area on a 300 millimeter wafer. You can do all the math again, and now all of a sudden, the precursor flow required is getting quite high. This is close to 1 gram per second precursor flow rate. We can make things worse. We can go to one of these big batch reactors with 150 wafers inside, or we can go to these, this is a Gen 10.5 glass plate. It's a 10 square meter glass plate that's actually being used in display industry to make your TVs and smartphones. They don't make it on this scale, they make it on this scale. And this is about the same surface area. If you do the math a little bit, 10 square meter area, we need more than 6 grams per second precursor flow. That is a lot. That is a challenge. So definitely we cannot use very simple precursor supply units that we have in our lab. We have to do something more complicated. So a reliable and efficient precursor, but also a gas supply, is vital for MLD and ALD reactors, especially if you go to upscaling, if you go to industry. And precursor supply systems can be quite complex. This is I took this from the website of one of our friends also here in the room from Sempa. They supply precursor supply cabinets for industrial scale systems. They can be quite complex, but they can also be quite expensive. And do not be surprised if an industrial scale precursor supply unit costs a lot more than an ALD reactor, actually. And there are three main methods used in ALD and MLD to supply precursors. There's vapor draw, using bubblers, and using direct liquid evaporation. Of course, there are many more varieties, but they're all based on these three main principles. And to start with vapor draw, I already explained it a little bit. It relies on a case where the precursor vapor pressure, so the vapor pressure for precursor in your vessel, is higher than your reactor pressure. Because if you then open the valve, then the vapor will automatically flow into your chamber because of the pressure difference between the precursor vessel and the reactor. And you can do the two options. You can do a hold mode and a flow mode. People use different terms for this, but I use the terms hold and flow. So the hold mode is where you indeed you open your valve, you let vapor flowing into your chamber, and then for some time. And then during that, you can also close your valve again, and the precursor is exposed. The substrate is exposed to your precursor, and the ALD reaction takes place. And then at some point, you close your valve again, and you flush your reactor. It's very simple. No complicated hardware. It can be quite efficient use of precursor. The problem is that your partial pressure might not be that well controlled. Because if you open the valve, then you probably get a pressure spike, but then during deposition, the substrate, but also the reactor walls, will extract precursor molecules from the gas phase, and precursor pressure will go down. But as the previous speaker said, who cares? because reaction rates in many cases are so fast that the surface is already saturated. As soon as you open the valve, everything is already saturated. That's true for small substrates. If you go to very poor substrates, where the effective surface area is very high, or if you use precursors with a very low vapor pressure, this can become a challenge. You can also do the flow mode, where you can also open the vacuum pump and you actively draw, you suck out the precursor from your vessel. You can put a flow controller in between to set your the precursor flow that you want, and you can even connect the flow controller to the valve of your pump to say if my flow is too high, I close the valve of the pump a little bit, and we can accurately control the flow. This gives you a better control of and stability of your precursor partial pressure. It is slightly more complex, but again, still relatively simple. Another often used method to supply precursors is using bubblers. So again, we have a precursor vessel with liquid precursor inside connected through a pipe and a valve to your chamber. But now we have a second pipe, so-called dip tube, that goes into the bubble, into the vessel, into the liquid. And if you blow in it, just as you do with your straw and your soda, you get bubbles. And this carrier gas, this can be nitrogen, it can be argon, this bubbles through your liquid, and while it goes up through the liquid, it picks up precursor from liquid, and then of course this flows directly into your precursor chamber. And this works best when the precursor vapor pressure is lower than the reactor pressure, because otherwise the whole concept would probably not work that well. So either this uses for very low vapor pressure precursors, or we use this for high reactor pressure. So people who do atmospheric pressure ALD, like I do in our lab, we don't use vapor draw, we use bubblers to supply precursors into our reactor chamber. It gives you a better control and stability of your partial pressures, but again, it's slightly more complex because now you need additional flow controllers. You need to have a vessel with a bubbler in there. So that makes it a little bit more complex. And if you use very high flows, then it's a little bit less efficient because picking up precursors from your liquid while bubbling through, there's a limit, of course. If you put in too much flow, the whole thing can start to froth, to make a foam of your precursor, and then you get, maybe you push some liquid precursor into your reactor, and then liquid precursor gets into your pump, and then that's mayhem. We would like to prevent that from happening. So if you go to really, really large scale production, where you have to supply very large quantities of precursor in a very controlled way, or in case that you have, for instance, solid precursors that you have difficulty evaporating, but maybe you can dissolve them in a solvent and then evaporate the whole solvent with the dissolved precursor in there, you can use direct liquid evaporation. There are several ways how people do this, but they all come down to the same principle. We have here, this blue part is the liquid source. This can be either liquid precursor or dissolved precursor, and you push this through a very small hole, the orifice, and you mix it in with some carrier gas. Again, this can be nitrogen, this can be argon, and this carrier gas is preheated to the desired temperature. Then you sort of vaporize this liquid, and then you transport it into a heated channel. And if you do it correctly, then at the end of this heated channel, all the precursor has been evaporated, brought to the vapor phase, and then transported with your carrier flow to your reactor. There's Chemstream having something based on this concept. There's Bronckhorst doing something based on this concept. So then you need this liquid evaporator, which is like this box over here. Then you need, of course, a flow controller for your liquid precursor, and you need a flow controller for your carrier gas. Everything has to be heated. You have to control pressure. So it's a great way of supplying large amounts of precursors, but it's rather complex. It gives you very accurate control of flows and partial pressures, useful for high precursor flows, but it's complex, and because you need many of these high-tech components, it can also be rather expensive. I have to say, from personal experience, one of the added drawbacks of liquid evaporators is that you have actually a line pipe filled with liquid precursor. So with bubblers and with vapor draw, there's only vapor, there's only gas in your lines. In this case, you have often steel lines filled with liquid precursor. And this liquid precursor can be TMA. You can use such a system to evaporate TMA or diethyl zinc or these kind of things. So suppose something happens, like this orifice blocks or something goes wrong. You end up with pressurized liquid precursor in a steel pipe. And if you then by accidentally open one of your connections, then you have liquid precursor blowing out. And this can be quite nasty, as you have seen in the movies shown today. This can lead to very, very, very risky situations. So unless you do this in a very controlled and very well-monitored, safely monitored system, probably not something that you want to do in your R&D system. So which evaporator should we choose? Well, the choice of the best evaporator system depends on the vapor pressure that you need and the thermal stability of the precursors. Also, if you have a small planar substrate, partial pressure is not that important, but if you go to porous substrates or to very large areas, then this becomes important. Of course, the type of ALD-MLD reactor, is it a very low pressure, is it a high pressure system? The throughput that you want, the precursor flow requirements that you have, and the level of flexibility is of course also very important. If you want to today make titanium oxide, tomorrow make zinc oxide, the day after that do an MLD reactor, etc., etc., you want to be very flexible, and you don't want to rely on very complicated stuff that works very well for one precursor but not very well for another precursor. If you want to do R&D, well, most of you will do R&D for the coming few years, keep it as simple, as flexible as possible. So probably don't go to a liquid evaporator system unless you really, really need to. In all cases, the maximum partial pressure achievable is the precursor vapor pressure. So the precursor vapor pressure gives you the maximum partial pressure that you can achieve, and high vapor pressure precursors will really be helpful in upscaling. If you have a low volatility MLD precursor in your lab, which means that you have to, because it's such a low vapor pressure, you have to dose for 10 seconds, who cares? I mean, this means that your deposition takes a little bit longer, but for your thesis, it doesn't really matter. If you then want to transfer this process to industry, where throughput is important, this becomes complicated. So where TMA is a textbook ALD precursor regarding vapor pressure, many more MLD precursors are more challenging. I showed you the vapor pressure of TMA and a silicon precursor before. Here we have the vapor pressure of the blue line is TMA, the red line is ethylene glycol, and the green line is hydroquinone. These are two sort of hybrid MLD precursors very often used for people who do ALD MLD for the first time. They use TMA combination with ethylene glycol. And you can see that the difference in vapor pressure as a function of temperature is 1 to 3 orders lower than for trimethyl aluminum. And these are still relatively small, low molar mass liquid MLD precursors. So you can imagine what happens if you go to more exotic or large or solid MLD precursors. The vapor pressure plummets, and doing a successful MLD reaction with some outlook towards upscaling this in the future is getting very difficult and prove a challenge for upscaling for MLD processes. So this brings me to my second and final summary about the second part of my presentation about ALD MLD reactors. There are many different types of ALD reactors. You can have a single wafer, you can have batch, you can have cross flow, plug flow. I didn't show all the varieties that exist, because that would take too much of your time and probably you're already a little bit tired. There are also many different ways of supplying precursors. You can use vapor draw, you can use bubblers, you can use direct liquid evaporations. There are several other things that you can do. But again, the best choice depends on the application and requirements. For a large part, existing ALD reactors and existing precursor supply systems can also be used to do MLD. ALD, MLD is in essence quite similar, and you don't have to do, and maybe look at the, you don't want to have sticky MLD precursors ending up in your pump, maybe you have to do something there, but for a large part you can use the same system. But the low vapor pressure and reactivity of many MLD precursors will require maybe some new equipment solutions if you want to do upscale MLD. So we have to think about what are new and more efficient ways of supplying low vapor pressure precursors into my reactor. And of course, how to get rid of it after a reaction. What can we do to, if we cannot increase, what can we do to decrease cycle times? If we cannot, of course, the people work on MLD precursors, they should make very reactive precursors, as reactive as possible, and as volatile as possible. But there's always a limit. So what can we do in terms of hardware to minimize cycle time, for instance, through minimizing purge times? So what can we do there to make MLD reactions as fast as possible and with that achieve as high throughput as possible? And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention. And if there are any questions, please let me know.
Injection, you mentioned the gas, heated gas. Is it also possible to use this heated gas to control your reaction pressure? Like really on the surface, on the substrate? Is this something you can comment on?
So the question is, let me go back to the... The question is, if you have a liquid evaporation system, you use heated gas to evaporate your liquid precursor. And this heated gas is transported with your vapor to your reactor, and can use this heated gas to heat up your reactor. That is possible. It depends on the efficiency of heat transfer from the gas to your substrate. And in many cases, the substrate is lying on a metal chuck, or some chuck, and the thermal mass is quite high. And the heat transfer coefficient is not very efficient. So so yes, it might help a little bit, but you always need to rely on other heating methods. The other way around, because usually your deposition temperature is, I don't know, 150 degrees C, you don't want to heat up your precursors to 150 degrees C in most cases. So actually the temperature of this gas is lower, sometimes much lower, than your deposition temperature. So you have to prevent cooling of your substrate due to the gas flowing over the substrate. But also again here, because usually the substrate and the chuck on which it lies has a high thermal mass, and the effect of cooling can be negligible.
Yeah, I have one. So in this calculation, so you have the reaction probability.
Yeah.
Can you a little bit detail what you mean? So is that the sticking probability or utilization efficiency?
I said, don't pin me down in numbers because these are just examples. Some people.
I know, yeah, but yeah. I'm still paying because so, it can be a factor of 10 easily. So
yeah,
depending
yeah.
Which one you mean.
Yeah. So some people use the term sticking coefficient or sticking constant or sticking fraction that tells you something about if I have like 1,000 molecules hitting my surface, only one or a few of them will actually react. Some people call this reaction probability. It's not really the same, but also not really different. Some people use only a kinetic coefficient, in which someone is also a measure of sticking coefficient. It is just to let you know that there is a finite reaction efficiency. Not every molecule hitting a surface will react. Of course, you want to have this number as high as possible. In this case, you could see there's a sort of sticking coefficient. That was my the purpose of this calculation.
Yeah, so my point here is that when we go to cross-flow reactors, so there are much more than a single collision per molecule. So
yep.
Meaning that if it doesn't stick during 100 first collisions, it still can make another 100 collisions before it comes out.
Yep.
And that's a very important factor in increasing utilization efficiency.
Yep.
Which is kind of a good news, so that you could take a 1-0 away if
yep.
you have this kind of a taking yep. place. So it's, you know, I just want to point out to the students so that these aren't completely different two things. sticking probability is defined per single collision,
yep.
While frequency utilization is that times the number of collisions they undergo while traveling through the reactor, and that can be pretty large number.
Yeah, you are absolutely right. Thank you. Of course, this was a sort of introduction. And ALD, MLD is in reality much more difficult and much more complicated as I presented here, as you will notice during your PhD. But this is probably you will touch upon these topics in future workshops, where like not only reaction sticking coefficient and precursor utilization, but also things like transport effects and flows, and this all plays a role. But let's not try. Let's not bother you with these things to start already.
I have a question a bit similar. So this number of the percent of utilization is quite low, but does it mean that the rest get completely wasted, or is it recycled somehow, like 99% of the precursor?
So as I said before, it's not utilization, it's sort of collision frequency, the chance that the colliding molecule reacts, and if you have multiple collisions, then the utilization, so the percentage of precursor that actually ends up in your layer, increases. But you're right, the precursor utilization is never 100%. So you apply a certain pressure of precursor, a part of that ends up in your layer, and the rest is being purged away to your pump, or to your abatement system. You might be able to recycle. So maybe if you put a cold trap after your reactor, you might be able to condense some of the precursor that has not been reacted. Then you have to purify it, and then you have to again put it in a vessel. And if you deal with these pyrophoric precursors like TMA, this is scary. In that case, you might prefer on just trying put it to a scrubber and get rid of it. But it is possible to recycle, and I know some people who are actively looking at this. But of course, this adds costs. You don't have to buy a new precursor if you can recycle some of the precursor that's not reacted. But you have to put a machine that collects, condenses the remaining precursor. You have to purify it again and then putting it back into your system. And if this is more expensive than buying a new precursor, don't do it.
And then another question: if in a spatial process, so there are two precursors at the same time, just in different areas, but when they go to the pump, do they go to the same pump and do they react in gas phase on the outlet? Or what happens there?
Yeah, let me go back to lots of slides. So the question is, in spatial ALD mode, we supply two precursors at the same time. The question is, do the both of the precursor exhaust flows, do they go to the same pump? Not in our case, depends. If your pump is able to survive that, then it's fine. Most cases, that's not true. So it's not only you supply the precursor separate, but you also remove them separately. Because you don't want to have them ending up at the same pipe at some point, because otherwise you start to coat the inside of your pump and you get powder everywhere. So also the separation of the precursors should be done and kept as long as possible, have kept separate. In our case, they only see each other, both precursors, they only meet up each other in a scrubber. So both gases go to the same scrubber to remove the precursors.
Can you just give us an overview of what's the industry standard on solid precursors?
So what's the industry standard on solid precursors? So what do you mean with industry standard?
There are a lot of, and in the academic space, using solid precursors, mostly using like an OVPD tubular reactor with a boat. Yeah. This is actually what we use in like large scale reactors using solid precursors.
I think the industry standard is to avoid solid state precursors where possible. But a well-known example of maybe less in ALD but a lot in CVD of a solid state precursor is trimethyl indium. Trimethyl indium is used a lot in CVD for making LEDs, indium gallium nitride LEDs, but also some of the applications. This is a solid precursor, but it's still relatively high vapor pressure, so you can even use a bubbler to evaporate it. If you have a low vapor pressure solid,
and you really cannot find an alternative, then you have to do complex things like, I don't know who it was, but they showed a very complicated precursor vessel with many plateaus and a sort of tortuous path for your precursor to flow through, to pick up as much precursor as you can while going to the reactor, then that's the way to do it. At some point you will reach a limit in the partial pressure of precursor flow that you can achieve, and then the only thing you can do, if that's not enough, is to slow down your ALD reaction, so to increase your precursor pulse time to make sure that you reach saturation. But it makes life complicated. So one of the problems with solid precursors is that, well, there are many, many challenges. One of the challenges that can happen is that you actually do not only transport vapor, but also powder. If it becomes really fine powder, it gets picked up by your flow, and can get into your reactor, and powders, particles, that's detrimental for many, many applications where people want to use ALD. So if possible, please try to avoid using solid-state precursors. Also, companies like Sampa will be grateful if you do.
Maybe one question myself for the spatial ALD, where the slide is now being shown.
Yeah.
You can imagine that very clearly for like flats or reasonably flat substrates.
Yeah. Like
from a moment that you would go to substrates that have like deep trenches etched
yeah.
into them or like high aspect ratio features, you can imagine that also the gas will need some time to get into
yeah.
these features and then to get out of them again.
Yeah.
Could you give like an order of magnitude estimate of like aspect ratios or surface area enhancement
yeah.
factors that people have managed to use in spatial ALD and like these deposition
yeah.
speeds can be still achieved in them? Because you can imagine that your wafer will probably need to allow the gas for the time for the gas to penetrate into the deep structure. You will probably not be able to shoot your wafer through the machine, but you will need to
yeah.
like let it progress at a lower speed. So could you give an estimate of
that? Yeah. Well, it's not an easy answer. So the point is, if you have a porous substrate, like if you have these trenches or you have like a sponge that you want to do ALD in. So ALD is famous for its conformality. So if you have a sponge, if you put it in an ALD reactor, then all the individual side walls of all the pores in the sponge will be coated by ALD layer if you do it correctly. But you can imagine that doing ALD in a sponge takes more time than doing ALD on a planar substrate. The reason is the precursor has to go into all the nooks and crannies of your sponge, of your porous material, and this takes time. It's diffusion. Diffusion is not very fast, so it takes time for all the holes to be filled up with your precursor and do the ALD reaction. This is of course true for all forms of ALD. It's true for low pressure, for high pressure, for temporal, for spatial ALD. That's just a diffusion of your precursor. If you want to minimize the cycle time, which we do in spatial ALD, then we also have to minimize the time it takes for precursor to diffuse to the bottom of your pores, but also for any reaction products to diffuse out. And this can be quite challenging. So we cannot use the same cycle time for a planar that we use for a planar substrate and a porous substrate. But what we can do is increase partial pressure, because one of the driving forces for diffusion is the difference in partial pressure between the bottom of your pore and the top. Let's say if the partial pressure in the beginning and the bottom of your pore is zero, and if you open the valve, then the partial pressure at the top of your pore is the vapor pressure. Then the higher the vapor pressure, the higher the partial pressure, the faster the diffusion will take place. And this can go quite fast. I mean, you're not necessarily required to stick to a reactor pressure of a few torr. You can go to higher pressures. If you go to higher reactor pressures, you can also allow higher partial pressures. If you have higher partial pressures, then the difference in partial pressure between the top and the bottom is higher, so diffusion is faster, etc., etc. And you can actually still do quite fast ALD in porous substrates. And that's what we do here. So in many cases, not in all, but in many cases, this is an atmospheric pressure process. So the reactor is at atmospheric pressure. So in theory, we could boil our precursor. We can boil TMA, fill everything with a high partial pressure of TMA, and then diffusion extremely fast. Now, we don't want to boil TMA. This will be mayhem waiting to happen. But still, we can use very high partial pressures. And that way, you can reduce your total cycle time as compared to still low pressure ALD, where you have a low partial pressure. But I think the point is that whether or not you do spatial ALD or temporal ALD or low pressure, high pressure, if you go to a porous substrate, then in most cases, the cycle time will increase. So the throughput in let's say wafers or plates per hour will decrease. That's a result of going to a porous substrate with this high effective surface area that you get in these kind of materials.
Okay, let's thank the speaker again.